My name is Melissa Marino, and I'm the chair of the Enterprise Forum for MIT Central Coast Chapter. And we are tonight having our last program of the season. So without further ado, I'd like to recognize and introduce my fellow board member and colleague and friend, Leslie Edwards, who's the Director of Corporate Business Development and Engineering and Sciences at UCSB. Leslie.
Well, first I must say thank you all. This is a standing audience, which doesn't happen very often. But I thought of this topic because maybe I'll have people raise their hand. How many people work or are affiliated with infrared in the 101 corridor? Yeah. Okay, so I'd say about 50%. The other thing that I think is little known is that we are a high-tech community and that the 101 corridor, the underpinning of that is infrared. So though it is not heralded, it is probably the reason why we have such an incredible technology community. I travel around the world as the Director of Corporate Business Development at UCSB, and I come back and I think, what a diverse community we have. And it would not be the case if it wasn't for infrared. So, Violet, I don't know if you're out there, but I was gonna give a little credit to UCSB. I don't know if I just forward the slides. Where did Violet go? But anyways, the other thing I wanted to mention is that the story tonight isn't really about UCSB. I hate to say it because I'm an alum. Raise your hand if you're an alum of UCSB. Ah, so about a third of you are. But I think Kevin, who has done an incredible job, so I'm so in awe of the work that he did, that I really would like to inspire him to write a book. So if those of you that are from the infrared community could, at the end of this event, come to Kevin or I and add to the research that he's done, you will see how much we have accomplished in infrared and mostly, or I don't know if I want to say mostly, but the University of Syracuse in New York. Had a lot to do with it. So I think my final question for you is, how many people are here who are not from Santa Barbara but came here for the infrared industry? Yeah, so it's about 15%. So thank you, because you've made our community very vibrant. Oh, so we're heading straight to Kevin's talk, so we'll jump over what I was going to talk about at UCSB. So our great good fortune is to have Kevin Riley here. I met Kevin probably within a year of him taking on Teledyne Scientific and Imaging, and I was just impressed with how far-reaching his thoughts were and how much he wanted to collaborate with universities. The one bragging point I will say is, out of the whole United States, UCSB is number 6th in terms of industry collaboration per faculty. So out of the UCs, we are by far and away the leader in terms of industry collaboration. And we've had a very long and kind of solid history with the infrared community. So Kevin has, in my mind, done something that I couldn't have asked anybody else to do, which is think of the biggest picture. Why is infrared, unbeknownst to a lot of you, the number one high-tech industry in this region? And I'm not just saying Santa Barbara, but the corridor. And tell us the story, but then look forward and tell us why it will continue to be vibrant, if not even a significantly growing industry. So with that, Kevin, who is not at Teledyne, as you'll see at the top of his bio, is a consultant, will give us what is hot about infrared, and then we will go to our exceptional panel members. So thank you, Kevin. I'm going to clap for you right now because it's a lot of work.
Thank you, Leslie. And it's great seeing so many former colleagues and close friends here tonight. And our story about the Santa Barbara infrared development extends back over 65 years to just about the end of World War II. Our story has a lot to do about the sunshine here in Santa Barbara. It's a storyline filled with entrepreneurs, many of which are with us tonight, mavericks and dreamers that have made the impossible possible. It's indeed a tale of two universities, and Leslie's mentioned both of them, Syracuse University as well as UCSB, and the collaborations that have existed between those universities and the community, the industrial base here. And it's got a little bit of Texas in the story and a dash of the frozen north in the story. And it's a family tree of three generations with many branches to it. Before I begin, though, just to make sure we're all on the same wavelength, I've shown here the electromagnetic spectrum, the visible region between 0.4 and 0.7 microns, shown in the middle of the slide, and then the infrared region, which we'll talk about tonight. It's extending from about 1 micron in wavelength to about 10 microns in wavelength. Just to build on the infrared 101 theme, all thermal objects at any given temperature emit radiation. The sun at 6,000 degrees Kelvin emits in the visible, peaking in the yellow region, the sun we see. If we go to human bodies at about a little bit over 300 degrees Kelvin, you see that the peak of the radiation is in the 10 micron region of the spectrum. And that's one of the reasons that people over the years have been in search of detectors that are very sensitive in the infrared to have night vision devices that detect humans that can see when the sun isn't shining. If you're looking for rocket engines, at a hotter temperature in terms of thermal emission, you shift to shorter wavelengths. And you look in specific regions of the atmosphere where there are windows that don't absorb the infrared. And so two regions of high interest are the 3 to 5 micron region and the 8 to 12 micron region, where the atmosphere is transparent to the infrared. So human beings emit radiation at 10 microns. The atmosphere gives us the opportunity to see that radiation if we have detectors sensitive enough to see it, because the atmosphere transmits that radiation. We'll be talking about two types of infrared detectors, thermal detectors, and our panel tonight are all experts in the application of thermal detectors. These detectors essentially absorb the heat generated. Herschel, who discovered infrared in the 1880s, in fact used a prism and a thermometer to deduce that there was radiation beyond the visible. These detectors typically operate at ambient temperatures. They do not require cryogenic cooling. And the processes, and one of the unique things, and we'll be talking about a special material called vanadium oxide, that material system has been enabled to be integrated into silicon foundries. And that has opened up the application space for these detectors greatly. The most sensitive infrared detectors are photon detectors. Here, they're usually semiconductors. That 10 micron radiation is equivalent to a band gap of about a 10th EV. So you're dealing with very, very narrow band gap materials, which presents some unique challenges. One of which, these detectors, by and large, need to be operated at cryogenic temperatures. The physics becomes more complicated, and the engineering becomes greatly more complex because of the cryogenic operation. But they are indeed the highest sensitivity detectors that we have. Why infrared? And our panel tonight with Bill Parrish, Art Stout, and Stuart Clapper will talk a lot more about this. but night vision in general, threat detection, target identification, security systems, situational awareness. Today, drones and robotics, heat detection, thermography, IR spectroscopy. The application space has opened up greatly as our technology has matured. So what is the current state? What exists here today? And I'm looking at about a 100-mile corridor from Malibu to Santa Ynez. It is the center of infrared research, development, and production. It is the industry here is coincident with the entire development of the infrared technology, about 65 years in duration, spanning the development of all the key IR technologies. RVS, FLIR, Lockheed Martin, Santa Barbara Focal Plane, Teledyne Imaging Systems, the former Hughes Research Labs, HRL, Autoliv, Seek Thermal, and SBIR, just to name the major players in the community. My estimate is that they own about a 50% market share of a global economy, and a global addressable market that is in excess, depending on how you define that addressable market, in excess of $2 billion. So we have about $1 billion of revenue generation here in the corridor out of these companies. In addition to that, we have the market leader in the military systems, RVS, the former Santa Barbara Research Center. We have the leader in commercial, FLIR Systems, the former Indigo Systems. We have the leader in automotive with Autoliv, and we have the leader in astronomy with Teledyne Imaging Sensors, the former Science Center down in Camarillo. In addition, these, seven organizations are the strategic operations of corporations with a market capitalization of over $200 billion. The work that is done in these organizations enable and leverage billions of dollars of product at the corporation operations. So these organizations are not only important to our customers, they're also essential to the corporations that these organizations are embedded in. So that is just a sense of what exists here today. And out of that $1 billion, it should be stated, it is individuals that are like the individuals in this room. Over the 65 years, the engineering and the technical support, the people that have come to the area, as Leslie indicated, and have devoted their careers to this industry have made a difference. So there's been a tremendous development of the local workforce that serves these companies. I thought it was interesting in my conversations with Stuart as to when Autoliv decided and Stuart decided where to set up operations. They chose Santa Barbara because it was indeed the hub of infrared development. Our IR history, I tried to put together a chart that shows the heritage. So if we take that current state of the organizations that we just mentioned and we go back in time, it begins with a gentleman by the name of Dave Evans. I'll talk a little bit more about Dave Evans in a minute, but he was Howard Hughes's radio man. He won a contest. He was hired by Howard to support his worldwide flight, and then he was given the opportunity to head engineering operations for Hughes in the late 1940s. Dave was a real maverick. He was an individualist. He was ambitious, and his wife's sister lived in Santa Barbara. So he decided to form a company, and that company, after a couple of false starts, became Santa Barbara Research Center. And it was incorporated in April of 1952. Syracuse University, and I was Dr. Levenstein's last PhD student. Dr. Levenstein, Doc, started his program in the late 40s after World War II. And Syracuse University did fundamental research in IR detectors, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. So our local community, starting with Santa Barbara Research Center, spans the entire development of the modern age of infrared detectors that extends back these 65 years. Santa Barbara Research Center was acquired by Hughes in 1956, acquired by Raytheon in the late 90s, and is today integrated with the former Amber Engineering that Bill Parrish founded, and as Raytheon Vision Systems, one of the world market leaders in infrared detectors. Bill is a serial entrepreneur, as we all know. I like to call it the Bill Cubed effect. Bill, after founding Amber, founded Indigo, grew Indigo to almost $100 million, sold it to FLIR Systems, and FLIR Systems today, the commercial operations here in town, and Art Stout will talk more about those operations, is the world leader in commercial applications. RVS, FLIR Systems locally, are the largest infrared organizations in the world. Bill, of course, will talk tonight about his new venture with Seek Thermal. Stuart will talk about his operations with automotive, with Autoleave. Spinning out also of SBRC, and Bill got his start at Hughes in Santa Barbara Research Center, and we were in the same corridor, about two offices away in the late 1970s. But Charlie Burgett came out of Santa Barbara Research Center and founded what is now Lockheed Martin's Santa Barbara Focal Plane Operations. Mark Massey came out of Amber Engineering, and Mark is here with us tonight, and founded Nova Systems along with Chris Baxter. And that has been purchased by Teledyne and is part of the Teledyne operations. And Steve McHugh, who is also with us tonight, came out of the former EOIR organization. I remember EOIR being located down in Carpinteria, and Art Cousins of EOIR was one of the old timers in the community building test equipment for the community. Feeding this pipeline is indeed two universities, and beginning as early as the late 1950s, there was a gentleman by the name of Howard Briggs, who was a colleague of William Shockley's, the inventor of the transistor, and Howard came to Santa Barbara, I don't know for a fact, but presumably to retire with the high quality of life of Santa Barbara. And Howard Briggs taught at the university as well as collaborated and consulted with SBRC. So the earliest interactions between UCSB and the infrared community dates back to the late 1950s. Santa Barbara Research, founded by Dave Evans, Howard Hughes' radio man, acquired by Hughes in 56. I think it was interesting that the initial culture was both competitive before it became collaborative. A lot of clashes with respect to the initial development of the original application back in those days was for missile seekers. Hughes was working the Falcon Seeker, and Santa Barbara Research Center was working the Sidewinder. A lot of cultural clashes in the early days, which led to the replacement of Dave Evans shortly after Hughes reacquired SBRC. The early facilities were located in essentially homes or former schools at Mission Canyon on De La Vina Street, and then into the airport site and former military buildings at the university. And the initial projects of SBRC were, and I think this is another interesting fact, our industry, and I'll talk a little bit more about this in a minute, got its start as government-funded research. A lot of the IP came out of either universities or essentially central research labs, corporate-funded central research labs, and then government sponsors. And our industry has been blessed with a lot of insightful individuals that, from the government side, that had a vision and funded that vision in operations such as ours here locally. The initial projects at SBRC were the Star Tracker out of Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, the Sidewinder out of the Navy, and Nimbus out of NASA. And Santa Barbara Research Center was an early mover in terms of collaborating and doing projects with NASA, and that is contributed greatly to the development of Santa Barbara Research Center. I already mentioned Dr. Howard Briggs with the collaboration. Just briefly with Professor Levenstein, he had from 47 to 77, 30 continuous years of government-sponsored research on campus in a technology that was military sensitive. You know, his ability to keep that project going was outstanding. His program did research into the 4.6s, the 3.5s, the 2.6s, as well as the extrinsic germanium silicon detectors. He had about 38 students, 10 of which joined Santa Barbara Research Center. So it was a strong pipeline. Don Bode was his first PhD. I was his last PhD. And in between, there were Peter Brott, Paul Cha, John Standard, Frank Renda, Paul Norton, Art Lockwood, as well as Moshe Lanier. And shown in the picture in the lower left is Professor Levenstein with Don Bode, who was at SBRC at the time, and George Pruitt, who is with TI Central Research Labs. In the early days of Syracuse, there was no industrial base, so incoming graduate students would actually fabricate the detectors, and some of these detectors shown in these glass doors were the earliest devices that were used in support of some of the military research at the time. I'm not going to dwell on there were also TI Central Research Labs, Honeywell Central Research Labs, and there was a pipeline of individuals that came from TI, that came from Honeywell, that made a tremendous difference to our technology. The TIers provided a, as you might expect, a semiconductor process focus. The Honeywellers provided a device physics focus that led to some fundamental understanding of the technology. The UCSB pipeline, as we've mentioned, earliest collaborations with Briggs, umpteen graduates, including Bill Parrish here tonight, collaborations across the departments, the use of the nanofab facilities to support fabrication of devices, tremendous contributions from UCSB into our community. In the interest of time, I'm going to skip that slide. And over time, from those earliest devices that were housed in those glass doors that were single elements, today, along with the maturation of the CMOS technology, as line widths have been pushed down by Moore's law, more and more electronics can be embedded into the unit cell behind the infrared detectors, enabling smaller pixels that is shown in the chart to the lower right, pixel size coming down to the 10 micron, sub 10 micron region, and array size is growing from initially single elements to today 4K by 4Ks being built. Community recognition of the corridor has resulted in the industry giving over 8 Herschel Awards that have been given on a periodic basis in recognizing key technology developments. Those awards have been shared in large part by Raytheon Vision Systems and Teledyne Imaging Sensors, and Levenstein Awards also given to individual members of the community for their career achievements in infrared. As I start to shift to the panel tonight, and they're gonna take us to one limit of SWaP, the small accessible devices that are integrated with cell phones, and I just wanted to share the VISTA focal plane array. RVS built and delivered the VISTA focal plane array in the mid-2000s. It's a module of 16 2K by 2Ks. So over 64 million pixels being put into a ground-based telescope to image the furthest reaches of space. We can talk all night about the difference our products have made to saving lives for the military in terms of the military applications. The panel will talk all night tonight about the difference our products are making in terms of the ubiquitous sensors that are becoming available and the information we can get through our automobiles or cell phones. But I think it's cooler than cool that our devices are reaching back to the very origins of the universe. And within our generation, within these past 25 years, cosmologists using our technology are deducing the origins of the universe. And I think that is just cooler than cool. I won't talk much on this slide. Vanadium oxide has become the material of choice for uncooled thermal detectors. Honeywell Research Labs developed the technology. It was classified for a long time. The patent was issued in the early 90s. To date, by my count, there have been over a dozen licenses given by Honeywell to the community to exploit the benefits of that technology. The panel tonight will be talking a lot about the use of vanadium oxide uncooled detectors in their applications. How large is large? Well, Maxtech estimates the uncooled thermal market is $2 billion today and doubling over the next 5 years. Our IR industry started with IP created in universities and research labs. It was supported by grads from local universities and schools. It was inspired by the entrepreneurs in the beginning, Dave Evans. More recently, Bill Parrish Cubed, Charlie Brigette, Steve McHugh, Stuart Clapper, Mark Massey, and others. It was government supported as well as corporate funded research. It had the characteristics of being very, very complex physics with highly engineered subsystems, proprietary technology, closed systems, characterized by vertical integration with real barriers to entry because of those capital and process intensive processes. Complex engineering due to the cryogenics, complex engineering due to the fact that you were dealing with heterogeneous structures. What's next? I'd like to turn it over to the panel and hear from Bill Parrish, co-founder and CTO of Seek, Art Stout, Vice President of Security at FLIR Systems, and Stuart Clapper, Managing Director of Autoliv in the automotive. Thank you very much.
I just have three charts, talk a little bit about the industry to follow up what Kevin has talked about, but more in line with the economics that the technology has brought us over the last decades. If you put on the progression of the cost of a generic infrared camera as a function of time, it looks like a nice straight line on a log versus linear time plot here, and you can just see it, you know, moving down, looking like Moore's Law or something. But if you really analyze what's happened here, it's all about disruptions. It's all about some new technology or some new approach to the business that's caused this industry to now change from being primarily the domain of the military, as it was about the end of the Vietnam War here in the early 70s until today. And early on, we saw $250,000 cameras being delivered to the Department of Defense. These were scanned cameras. They were cryogenically cooled, as Kevin talked about. And only the military and maybe a few industrial users could actually afford such a thing to see infrared light. Along the way, there was a business opportunity that came about with the realization that you could build the underlying substrate to these infrared detectors, which are two-dimensional arrays, very, very similar to a visible, except for you have to put these exotic semiconductors like Mercad telluride or indium antimonide on top of them and connect them through something called an indium bump. But at that time, there was a realization that you could buy the underlying signal processing silicon from a foundry, and we decided to start a company here called Amber Engineering, and realized that most department heads had a capital budget in their discretion that was about $50,000. In fact, it was $50,000. If we came in at $49.95, we didn't have to wait for a capital cycle, so we priced a camera at $50,000, and lo and behold, it worked, and there were a lot of government laboratories and industrial applications that kind of came out of the woodwork that would buy some of these cameras. We had extremely high volumes now. We would sell, I don't know, 100 or 150 cameras a year, and we could get $49,000 for them. But what came with this was really a disruption. It wasn't this linear progression here that got the cost down. It was a conscious decision that the cost needed to be down to achieve the goal of selling more into an industrial fixed price camera design. And along came FLIR with a new technology, this uncooled microbolometers. Kevin talked about thermal detectors. These were the new Honeywell designed or patented concept where you could just collect the heat from this infrared source, and these detectors could tell that there was infrared impending on the pixel. So with that, without removing the cryogenic cooler out of this camera and removing it, all of a sudden you could get to $10,000. And my business partner Tim Fitzgibbons said, he was at Rockwell International at the time, soon to become Boeing, decided he would become a commercial purveyor of these uncooled microbolometer focal planes, and FLIR bought them and put them in cameras. And the cameras at that time went from $20,000 to maybe less than $10,000, but as you can see, it's right on the line. And FLIR, this is where FLIR and Agema and Informetrics started their really getting into the industrial commercial world, selling these things for predictive preventative maintenance. You could look at them, you could look at a motor and determine whether its bearings were going to wear out. So there were a lot of applications for these, and they sold these in the thousands. A little while later, FLIR's Indigo operation figured out how to build these devices and take the temperature stabilization out of them, and also could move the fabrication of the detector out of a very specialized kind of Geppetto operation here in Goleta. They moved it off to a real semiconductor foundry, and all of a sudden you could produce cameras and sell them for $2,000 and make lots of money. And these things were sold and heading for the tens to hundreds of thousands kind of quantities. This decade, both FLIR and ourselves at SEEK have decided that, yeah, all of a sudden now we have this thing called wafer-scale vacuum. These detectors all have to work in a vacuum. We could combine a MEMS technology that allowed us to put a vacuum encapsulation on top of the detector right on the wafer. So you could do a whole wafer of, 500, 1,000 arrays all at one time. And there's been a lot of other things coming along, including making the pixel size smaller, so the arrays got smaller, so you get more per wafer. And along that line, that was the next disruption, and here we are in 2015, and this is a story that you're going to hear a lot about from Art Stout tonight about, the world is full. It's going to become ubiquitous, so I think as FLIR calls it, you're going to have infrared everywhere. So if we move to the next slide, how do I do that? Give me a slide change here. We'll talk a little bit about what happens when you disrupt today's infrared market. Well, if you're selling cameras a few years ago for between a little under $1,000 to maybe a couple $1,000s for kind of a generic camera that you might sell to somebody in the construction trade, today there's been a shift that's going to push this cost because of the realization you can build these things lower cost. That'll push up the annual volume, the total addressable market in terms of volumes, it'll increase it perhaps 30 times. These are kind of notional numbers here I have over on the side, starting with 100,000, 1 million, 10 million, 100 million kind of quantities, but that's kind of an approximation, keep it at that. But what's happening, the evolutionary market dynamic would move it very slowly along this line, but what really happens is there's some innovation coming along, and the innovation is all this new technology that's come. Unfortunately, when you decrease the price, even though you've increased the volume, the total addressable market in terms of dollars actually doesn't grow quite as fast because you've got to sell a lot more of them to make up the dollars you're losing, And at the same time, you have a problem with adoption rate because all of your old cameras that were selling at $2,000, now you got to get them off the shelf because they're going to be sold now at $200. So it generates a little bit of disruption in the marketplace for the existing people. As you continue to reduce the price, you will not gain as many new users as you do losing revenue as your costs go down. So we call this area commoditization. And for today's world, we're sitting kind of at the peak of this total addressable market. It may be change and it'll go up as we see more and more applications for this thing. But sooner or later, the costs will come down because of new technologies, and you'll end up with a commoditized product like a visible camera. Disruptive pricing today stimulate the price-sensitive markets. There are people that couldn't afford it before that can for whatever particular application they might have had. They knew about thermal imaging, but they just couldn't afford it. But all of a sudden, if the price drops by an order of magnitude, now all of a sudden you can use it. The TAM dollars, total addressable markets, increase by 3x. There's going to be a redistribution in market shares amongst the players. People that have stuck with their very expensive cameras now are going to have a hard time finding the source of these components to keep their market share because it's a whole new world. People with that benefits agile competitors, people that empowers the vertical system integrators, maybe some OEM customers can now buy low-cost camera cores that they can put in their products. But people like FLIR who have all this technology will actually do very well. The adoption transition rate will be rapid. I'm going to say rapid in terms of years, not months. But there are some very price competitive marketplaces. There is a big pent-up demand for thermal imaging out there. People have known about the technology, would love to have it, just couldn't afford it, and now they can. And there's been an industrial to consumer business transition with new channels. All of a sudden, instead of having a salesman go out on the street and try to sell a camera one by one, you find them hanging on a peg in Home Depot. So it's a whole new world in terms of how you sell these things. Again, the technology came from semiconductor foundry fabrication techniques now. We're in a very large fabrication facility that can produce these wafers in tens or hundreds of thousands a year. We have this wafer level vacuum package called WLP. We've got some new algorithms that allow you to build these things in very high volume and still be able to calibrate them. The optics world has participated in having moldable and wafer level optics. And of course, the semiconductor business and our new microprocessors out there help us build these things at low cost. Make another point is that when we started out, we talked about a military market, and there still is a very large military market, but the consumer, commercial, industrial market has now dwarfed it. And so all of a sudden you see the social benefit of thermal imaging come into play. We can save lives. You'll hear about that from Stu Clapper tonight in terms of how it's going to help our automotive business. Firefighters use it to get out in the fire. It's being applied in medicine. We save energy with this stuff. There's nothing better than a thermal camera to figure out where your heat's going. So doing energy audits on homes, industry, buildings really help out. And of course, the economics of seeing a market, total addressable market increase here in the United States as well as Europe is a very positive effect. Can I have, next slide here. Basically, something about our effort. Seek Thermal is really a partnership between Raytheon, who has the finest intellectual property in this area in the world. You heard from Kevin. It's part of the old Santa Barbara Research Center and has continued from there. They are focused on military and high-end security products, very large focal planes, and just really an exceptional source of intellectual property. Freescale, of course, has the internet, is the old Motorola semiconductor. They've got tremendous MEMS capability and a very, very tight relationship with automotive participants and ourselves, who are really after the commercial consumer product. So this is who we are and what we're doing. So with that, I think the next one up is Art.
Well, before I begin, I'd like to thank Leslie for picking this topic and reaching out to the business community and selecting the speakers this evening. As Bill described, I mean, this is a significant time in this marketplace as we transition from sort of a B2G or government business and B2B to B2Consumer. And it's an exciting time for the folks. Most of us here have been in the industry for a long time, so it's a new world. So FLIR has positioned itself as the sixth sense. You know, the thermal imaging extends the range of vision beyond visible, and there are just a very significant number of applications and use cases for this, and we're trying to exploit that. So FLIR is going to be the world's sixth sense. We're going to improve the way we live by bringing innovative sensing technologies to daily life. We want to make our world safe and aware, our environment clean, healthy and entertained, and our economies efficient and productive. And FLIR will be everywhere. We do have this slogan of infrared everywhere that sort of drives us. Our senior management coined that phrase some time ago. Our innovation is renowned. Our brand, ubiquitous. And I'd like to just touch on that for a bit. Later on in the presentation, I'm going to talk about some of the challenges in terms of growing this business. And one of the big challenges is awareness. I was joking when we came in and talking with my wife and some of the folks here about how even within this community, you can talk to your neighbors and they ask you, what do you do and who do you work for? And they've never heard of the company, nor are they really all that familiar with the technology. So even though for all of us here who are in the industry, you know, we're absorbed, we're immersed in it, but there's a big population out there that still does not fully understand the benefits of this technology. So we're out there through our brand efforts to change that and hopefully drive adoption. So FLIR is a very large company. We have five business units, and we have everything from a very high-end military business in which we sell products that have price points over $1 million, and we have consumer products today and component products that are sold for in the hundreds of dollars. But across that spectrum of price points and markets, We have the strategy of what we call controlling the corners. So we want to be strong across that by leveraging certain areas of technology. Bill was the innovator that sort of brought the foundry process to the readouts or these devices that he described, and that was a big innovation in the industry. And we continue to have an excellent internal capability to drive innovation at the chip level. But it doesn't matter if it's a $50 product or $1 million product, you need innovation at the chip level, and we continue to push on that or pull on that lever. So if you look at the price points, as I said, in the upper corner, you could be at $1 million sort of targeting pod with laser designation and all sorts of payloads in this highly stabilized product. And then at the low end, and I have some samples here after we get done speaking, we can show you some of our cell phone accessories. But when you look at this, we've really tried to focus not only on a technology leadership position, but on performance leadership position, because technology innovation is so important. It doesn't matter if it's an inexpensive product, the technology that's involved in the design and the manufacture of inexpensive products is sometimes greater than even the most expensive products. So, performance leadership is really what the customers at the high end are focused on. So we have great domain knowledge, intellectual property. On the lower side, it's our vertical integration. We sell components. We're a merchant supplier of technology at the core level, but we've also created a lot of vertical markets. So we are dominant in test and measurement equipment. We're dominant in fire cameras. We're dominant in night vision for law enforcement, for boaters, all these types of vertical markets, and we continue to create new products and just continue to just focus on use cases and bringing really good products and driving the cost. So we have aggressively lowered the cost, whether it's throughout the legacy from Amber through Indigo through now FLIR, and now companies such as Seek Thermal coming into the marketplace. We are really focused on driving cost and really finding that inflection point in the demand and create high volume markets. For FLIR, we have a lot of different businesses, but our focus is thermal. It's our growth driver. And so we continue to develop, focus on brand awareness and technology awareness, and we're going to focus on leadership and cost. And the product that we're focused on is what we call the Lepton. So this is really was designed as a cell phone module. And you can imagine you go to an engineer and you said, okay, traditionally you've made products to fit this particular form factor, to have this particular power consumption capability, these types of optics and such, and say, now we want you to make something that's 8 millimeters, you know, by 5 millimeters. And you can imagine just what a big engineering challenge that has been. And this is the output of thousands of man hours of work, many enormous investments by the company, and some real innovative breakthroughs in terms of packaging. This has a custom ASIC that drives it. So we bought an optics company that was pioneering in the manufacture of molded lenses, or I should say lenses printed on a wafer scale. And so we bought that company, and we have brought that technology in-house and continue to drive on all the things, whether it's packaging, optics, peripheral electronics, or the sensors themselves. And today we have a whole family of products that are incorporating this low-cost sensor. We've got our FLIR product, our cell phone products. We've got a test and measurement product, a machine vision product. We've got a night vision product or a security camera. We've got another test and measurement system there for building and home inspectors, that type of thing, very low price point. And we also have a next generation FLIR One, which will be available to purchase in about 5 days. June 25th, I think, is the launch date. Okay. So I think a number of the speakers have elaborated on this, but just to go through this quickly, you can see in the darkness, you can see through obscurance. In the case of firefighters, I don't know how many people are familiar with this, but the particulate size of smoke in a burning building is such that the combination of that particular particulate and the wavelength, just like we have these atmospheric bands that we can see through smoke very clearly. And so firefighters have found this technology to be quite life-saving. We can do very long-range imaging because of the low atmospheric interference, and we can detect people and animals. And because gases have very specific spectral emission bands, we can filter cameras and we can see gases, and we have a whole range of products that are designed to find gases. I think I want to just focus on this a little bit, and I think one of the key things for FLIR, and we talk about, or Bill talked about this rollover and such, and I think that, you know, that's certainly a phenomenon that we're, as an industry, going to face. But I think one of the things that we have to focus is we have to decouple infrared from a human person owning, operating, touching, holding that product. Because infrared sensors are now today in every bathroom fixture that you find. They become sensors, and those sensors combined with processing, edge-based analytics, cloud function, cloud computing, you know, there is an enormous amount of application for thermal imaging as an intelligent sensor to do something that is completely not obvious to us as consumers or interacting with that technology. So human detection. Imagine that, you know, intelligent street lighting, intelligent traffic systems, all sorts of things, gas detection, healthcare, environmental controls, people counting, you know, retail analytics, that type of thing. On the automotive side, Stewart's been and Autoliv have been driving this for a long time now, and the fruits of their effort are finally being realized in a very significant way. Pedestrian avoidance, obviously, autonomous driving. Inside the cabin, maybe some passenger intelligence capabilities. BMW just announced a gesture recognition capability in their new 7 Series. I'm not suggesting that the thermal is part of that, but thermal can be used for gesture recognition, which then, of course, can get into gaming and some other things, and environmental controls. On the consumer side, security is a big is a big play. A lot of security cameras have PIRs, or pyroelectric infrared detectors, that are motion sensors. And these devices are very short range and are very susceptible to providing false alarms, can't distinguish between a human being and pets and things like that. So imaging is very powerful. User interfaces, you know, for gaming and things like that, entertainment, biometrics, you know, thermal face, and other types of biometrics, and then again, night vision. So again, it's a big market, and this is sort of a chart that talks about where we are in terms of market adoption, maturity, and size. And you can see automotive is quite significant. The military is obviously the most known and viable. But these bubbles kind of give some sense as to the scale and of where this is going. And I would suggest that things like home automation, intelligence transportation, these bubbles over the next 10 years are going to be quite large. So it's going to be an interesting time. So the viability of thermal is based on lowering costs. It extends the utility beyond the image that a human is dealing with and interpreting. And awareness, well known in the markets, but rapidly gaining traction in security, and lower prices are driving machine vision and industrial applications. And I'll just close on this slide. Awareness, we feel, is one of the most important things to drive this market forward. And we have many ways and many tools to do that, but if I look at just some of the most recent postings of videos that we've done in support of our lower priced products, you start to see some significant views. So we get 1 million views of the haunted house, 1 million views of Red Bull Racing, and you start to see, you know, that this is quite large. But now, you know, we're starting to see this accelerate. So we had a recent YouTube video have over 13 million views. So in total, we've had over 20 million. We had over 20 million impressions on YouTube in 2014. That's all I have. Thank you.
Well, last but certainly not least is Stu Clapper, and then after that, we'll impanel all the speakers, and we hope we get a lot of questions. Thank you.
Okay, now that everybody's got you all warmed up, I thought I'd show you something that you could really use as drivers. So I'm going to start off a video.
It comes alive at night. It sees four times farther than your headlights, revealing unexpected dangers while maintaining exceptional comfort. Night View Assist Plus sees the risks before you do. This is the all-new S-Class, king of the urban jungle.
So I hope you enjoyed that. Okay, so again, I'm Stuart Clapper. I think you heard my name a few times tonight. I'll tell you a little bit about our company. Our company is a safety company. So if we don't do anything unless it's safety related. We're the largest supplier of airbags in the world. We're the largest supplier of seatbelt restraints. And you can see a car has a lot of airbags in it all over. It's not just the airbag coming from the steering wheel. It's all throughout your vehicle. We are also the largest supplier of infrared to cars. We also supply visible cameras and radars and everything else. And this is all in an attempt to someday make the car a very safe vehicle for us all to drive. You might ask the question, well, why are we putting this in the cars? This is, you know, I can drive at night. I don't need this. But if you look at the fatalities that occur on a yearly basis, it's around 4,000 people here in the US. Worldwide, it's probably over 100,000 people are killed every year. But look at that second statistic, deer vehicle accidents. Here in the US alone, there's about 1.1 million deer vehicle accidents every year. And that represents about $3.5 billion of property loss. So if you've ever hit a deer or any other kind of animal, you'll know that it's a terrible event, and you could lose your life in the event. And of course, when you drive at night, 69% of all fatalities occur at night, And there's a greater than four times greater chance that you'll have an accident at night with a pedestrian or an animal, and even though only 25% of our driving occurs at night. And if you hit a pedestrian, think about it. Sometimes we feel like our headlights are good enough and we know how to drive and our eyesight is good enough, but if you hit a pedestrian, you're gonna end up in court for about 2 years trying to figure out how to save your life for being sued by hitting this pedestrian. And it could be a very emotional thing, not only for the pedestrian, but for you as a driver. So the system we sell is quite complex. You might think it's simple, but it isn't. Making the infrared camera, as difficult as that is not the hardest part of this. It's actually doing everything we do in this electronic control unit. So I've got about 150 engineers that work for me in Sweden that are working on the electronic controller or the algorithms in that electronic control unit. And that's mounted either underneath the seat or underneath the dashboard in the vehicle. And then the camera, as you can see, is mounted in the grille section. Here's an example of an Audi implementation. So as you can see, looking out the windshield, you can't see, but looking at the display in the instrument cluster area, it's very nice and easy for a driver to see what's happening. So let's see if this works. But this is an example you can see, obviously. On the left is what you see out your windshield. On the right is what is visible with our infrared. And you can clearly see that there's an animal, a dog, and a person on a bicycle very clearly visible in the image. And then here, because it's really a cool video, shows on the left, again, what it looks like in total darkness. And then on the right, you can see at a very far distance the deer that happens to be in the middle of the roadway. And so, technical difficulties. Okay, so anyway, you can see at a very long range, it's very clear that you can see that there's a deer out there. Gives you plenty of time to stop the vehicle in time for you to not hit that deer. So as we talk about growth, today we're selling roughly 25% of the year of the global volume of night vision in the world on cars today. And you might wonder, well, I don't see that many of them in Santa Barbara. Yeah, there's quite a few cars here in Santa Barbara, but the fact is almost half of what we sell today ends up in China, because there's over 2 billion people there. They have over 100,000 people killed every year, and they really like technology. So a lot of cars that we put our system into, BMWs, Audis, Mercedes cars, Rolls Royce, they're all sold in China. So that's a big market, and it's gonna continue to grow. And you can see we expect about half a million, 500,000, systems being sold by the time we get to 2020. Now I hope you can see this one, probably won't, is what we call spotlight technology and spotlight function. And as you're driving down the road, this happened to scene, unfortunately you can't see it, is driving through Santa Barbara right by UCSB, and as you drive down the road, instead of seeing an infrared image, we actually put a spotlight on the pedestrians that are on the road. So it doesn't matter if they're on the left or the right. And as you know, a lot of people walk on the road by UCSB every night. And yeah. And so the spotlight technology actually puts a very nice beam of spotlight on the person that's out there. And we use the infrared to detect that person on the road, and the spotlight is directed, and we actually have two on each vehicle. Spotlight is directed onto the pedestrian and lights them up. And so just looking out the windshield, you drive like you normally do looking out the windshield, except you have a spotlight that you can see. So where are we going from here? We've heard about autonomous vehicles. Some of you might wonder, are they real? Are there something that's gonna happen? I could tell you our company alone is spending over $50 million this year alone on development of technology for autonomous driving, driverless vehicles. And we're just one of many. All the OEMs are spending enormous amounts of money in this area, and a lot of our competitors as well are spending money in this area. So you can think about where this has all come from. Back when first we had cruise control, you could take your feet off the accelerator and you could drive down the road. And now in 2015, there are cars you can buy where you can actually take your hands off the steering wheel and it will continue to follow the road for some period of time. And then we'll alert you when you have to put your hands back on the steering wheel. So that's actually available in the market this year. Eventually in 2018, we're going to get to the point where you can take your eyes off the road. So basically, we all like to text or we like to get on the phone or we like to do things. The car will actually have an extra set of eyes, actually multiple set of eyes, looking at the road ahead of us, and we'll be able to clearly prevent us from having an accident. And then when we get into the beyond 2020, you'll get to the point where you can just have your mind off, be totally in a chauffeured vehicle that allows you to just sit and relax and talk with your friends and play cards or play games and go on a long trip, and you'll get there safely. So with that, I'm going to close, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak tonight. I wish my videos had shown because they're pretty cool, but thank you very much.
Well, thank you, and that was great. I remember in the 80s, I don't know if anybody, maybe you should raise your hand, a couple that bought an RV had cruise control and thought that literally they could go in the back of the RV and prepare their lunch and ended up, you know, off the road, flipped over. Does anybody remember that story? Okay, maybe I made it up. So now what I would like to do is ask each of the panel members to have a seat, and we're going to ask questions and maybe talk about infrared history so that Kevin can complete his book. So as a moderator, I get to ask one or two probing questions, and I'm going to ask a question that will start from Kevin and we'll work our way down. I'm really concerned that infrared, which has been, you know, as you said, around for the last 50 years, actually has a hot competitor behind them that we might not be aware of. And just, you know, from curiosity, do any of you feel like there might be something, a technology that is even more far-reaching, maybe not as inexpensive right now, that the corridor, the 101 corridor, should be looking at? So, Kevin.
Well, I'll start off by, and some of the local companies are already working in this area, is the combination of active and passive imaging. So it's the use of a laser either as a flash illumination of the scene, or to get the active reflection from a LIDAR point of view. And so LIDAR systems and flash illumination is one area that has interest, and some of the local companies are actively engaged in both of those technologies.
I guess in our industry, we see a lot of activity with LIDAR devices as well. So, and also visible cameras are a commodity, as we've heard from Bill Parrish. So we really believe that there will be other technologies that will compete, but nothing really gives you the range that an infrared camera can actually give you.
One of the benefits of thermal as it relates to human detection, more specifically, is the contrast in thermal is extraordinarily high, and when you try to do analytics and bring intelligence to these devices, that contrast is very valuable to making the analytics perform very robustly and reliably. So other technologies, you know, will come along, and the active imaging, I think, is certainly one that will find wide adoption in a lot of areas. But as we continue to push on price and capability and analytics, I think, you know, our future is quite secure.
It'll really depend on the applications as well. Some applications, a millimeter wave imaging system have a lot of advantages, sees through things. And It'll come along and display some of the things we use infrared for today. But in general, the technology sees heat, and that's an important thing. And it definitely has a place. I don't think it's going to be displaced in too many areas. So
doesn't see through glass.
It can't see through glass. That's true.
Maybe that's a good thing. So I'm happy to open it up to the audience. We've got a lot of people in the room. So we'll start with Craig.
I'm a big fan of the mind-off vision. I hate driving, especially when I have to go to LA. So what are the key barriers that have to be overcome for that vision to be realized?
It's basically regulations. It's the technology is there. We've actually demonstrated the technology. Some of our competitors and certainly our OEMs have demonstrated the technology and the capability to do it. It's a matter of making sure the government regulations allow you to do it. You know, for example, in that video that didn't play that shows the light spot, it's today you can't put a light on a light spot technology on a car because the headlight regulations in the U.S. were established in 1968. And so think about now trying to put a driverless car onto the road and have that comfort of driving with somebody else, you know, some sensors on looking at the road ahead of you. The reality is without the regulations changing and some states are more progressive than others. Fortunately, California is kind of moving in the right direction. So that's really what it's going to take. There's places like Gothenburg, Sweden, where my company headquarters are in Sweden, where they've actually picked an area and roads where in 2019 you'll be able to buy a driverless car and be able to drive on all those roads with your hands off the road, off the steering wheel, and be totally autonomous. So it's all about regulations.
Okay, over there.
I was just curious, following up on that, I think cars now, manufacturers require to put in the backup cameras in cars. Is that something, an opportunity to make it an infrared?
Well, the commodity of a rear view camera, I mean, they literally sell for about $6 or $8, you know, so it's really hard to get an infrared camera down in that range. And invisible cameras see pretty well when you're backing up. But when you're looking forward and you need to see at least 40 yards down the road, and in most cases you want to see 100 yards or more down the road, infrared's really the only answer.
So we didn't spend a whole lot of time talking about the very expensive end of the infrared, which it might be a lot of the audience is unaware of. And it's on satellites, and it's been kind of the driver behind infrared. Maybe we'll start with Kevin, but talk about, you know, why we have gone from where we were to these bolometers and things that are so inexpensive. I mean, how, maybe.
So the premium for a lot of systems, and just to use the astronomy analogy again, in that community, every photon counts. And some of the expense is driven by the application where the customer, the end user, wants to capture every single photon with the highest fidelity. And that drives systems, that drives the performance, and in communities where the end user is willing to expend the dollars needed in order to get that level of sensitivity. I think the challenge as we look in the future is where you do get ubiquitous sensors and the proliferation of less sensitive sensors and yet the networking of them, and get the power of Metcalfe's law with respect to networked sensors, there, you know, which is more worthwhile, a $1 billion satellite sensor or a billion cell phones that are networked? Where is the higher information content between those two scenarios? And I think that's the power of the proliferation of some of these less expensive and just driving the numbers and yet networking of the information to capture the situational awareness that one wants. But there are some applications where that's not possible, and in those applications, sensitivity will and performance will drive price in applications where the end user is willing to pay the price in order to capture that information.
And number of pixels, you know, the size of these things. You showed some of these astronomy arrays with lots and lots of pixels, and of course that costs money, but it gives you the kind of resolution and ability to see things a long way with great fidelity.
I don't really have anything to add.
I'm all about small, cheap ones.
Okay, other questions? Well, there's somebody in the back.
Yeah, how many years do you think we are away from uncooled midwave that has the performance that you need to see what you need to see?
I'll make a comment. I think that's the bigger question is, you know, when is there going to be enough demand and funding to do it? This is not going to be done commercially. This would have to be done. I mean, obviously the U.S. Navy and some other military agency have focused or funded that, but the physics are very challenging. And I don't believe there's a commercial market for that. I think that's purely military, and I think companies like FLIR will not pursue that because there's just no commercial market for that. So my answer is it'll never happen.
Unless the government coughs it up.
Thank you. You guys talked a lot about consumer products, that infrared is going to reach these consumer products applications. So what is, in your opinion, are those applications? Why would I would want to buy an infrared camera and put it on my cell phone or something like this?
Well, it starts with some simple applications people can think about. Where's the cat at night when you look out the backyard? What's the dog barking at? And, a simple infrared camera, Art's got a bunch of them here, we'll do that, and it's kind of exciting. You can find heat leaks around your house instead of where to patch them up. You can use them for cooking if you want to know if your hamburgers are hot. You can look at the propane tank and see if there's propane in your propane tank. And the applications really, and I think this panel agree, we don't know yet what the killer application will be. We might, but think we do, but we really don't know until we get it in the hands of the consumer and they'll find something wonderful to do with it. It may be a game, it may be putting on makeup in the morning. We just don't know. So, but we do know of the applications that have been traditionally sold to or the ones that people keep asking us about, and there's lots of that. And Art mentioned the Internet of Things. Why did you put a microcomputer in my refrigerator? That just doesn't make sense, but I don't know one soul today that doesn't have it. So I've got them in the toaster now. So infrared will be as prolific, and we'll find all sorts of new and ways of using this technology.
I'll make one other point. If you look at Seek and FLIR in terms of what we've accomplished with these cell phone accessories, and you start looking at how you can leverage that customer base, and you can then look at what's going on in the app community. So the trial and error, that cycle of trial and error of innovative thoughts about the application of thermal imaging, just like when Apple introduced HealthKit or whatever, I mean, instantaneously they had access to data from tens of thousands, millions of people to collect data to drive medical research. It was an overnight epiphany, I think, for the medical community. So from our perspective, at least, if we can leverage and incentivize the app community to just continue to find applications, and that rapid cycle of trial and error will create use cases that we don't know about today, and the speed in which those things will become aware, that we'll all become aware of those, is going to be much more rapid than it's ever been because of the cell phone and these ecosystems and these app communities.
We've discovered we have a mountain lion in our neighborhood, so that's a good use of the infrared cameras. Hey, keep your cat and dog indoors. Okay, question back there.
In all these commercial applications you talk about, you are somewhat constrained by the export regulations as to what you can put in these systems. Can someone address how that is changing with time?
Could you just... What was the last part of that? I'm sorry.
How is that changing with time? How is that going to evolve, and how is that going to affect this business?
Well, today the export regulations are different depending on the technology. There is the Department of Commerce has certain jurisdiction, and the Department of State has jurisdiction over certain products. Today, we sell products with reduced frame rate. And those generally are available to be sold, as a consumer, without government licensing and such. And Stuart's obviously had a lot of experience with this, with more real-time systems, but obviously this continues to be a bit of a headwind, no doubt. But as an industry, I think we continue to, find ways to adapt and to meet the government's wishes and still create, economic benefit.
Yeah, and in the case of automotive, if we put a theft deterrent into the system, which we do, so that if the camera is stolen off of the vehicle, it can't be used. Or if we ship 500 or 1,000 cameras at a time somewhere, if they're stolen, you can't turn them on because of the theft deterrents associated. And because of that, the government has allowed us to ship them around the world. We can ship them to every country except for like Iraq and Iran and Cuba and some of the countries that are not so friendly to us at this point. So the bottom line is, even in China, we can sell in China, as I already mentioned, as long as we have theft deterrents in the system.
There's a lot of effort for the military to hold on to what they developed. And like liquid crystal displays, computer chips, GPS, name it, there's this general trend that the benefit to society, the economics of the country's exports and whatnot, just become so overwhelming and so important that the balance of what is exportable, not exportable, as well as the development offshore of our friends and competitors developing these technologies that are not restricted like ours, put a great deal of pressure and eventually cause these things to break loose. The question really is, will they break loose soon enough that we can continue to compete on a worldwide basis with the highest levels of technology required or expected by industry and consumers and all the various applications that we had? Government's been wise enough to allow the firefighters to ship to fire departments because it saves lives, and the automobile is as well, but there's going to be other applications that it just doesn't make sense to preclude us from being able to export. When that's going to change, not sure, but there will be, because of the amount of money and acceptance and pervasiveness and awareness, as Art said, this scale is tipping very fast.
I'd make one other point. It's an interesting one. There's an unintended consequence to U.S. policy, which is it's basically encouraged or forced or motivated, countries around the world to create their own capabilities in this important technology, and the proliferation that they were hoping to not see happen has in fact happened.
Back there.
Just a question while we're waiting for others is, how difficult is it going to be for the South Koreans and the Chinese and others to essentially knock us off?
How difficult is it going to be?
Or when will it happen, I guess?
Well, This technology, it's at least the ones that we're talking about today about proliferation, low cost, and whatnot, is copyable. It's the technology's out there, and they've been working on it for a long time. We will see foreign competition, and there's a question about export. We'd like the ability to freely compete.
Okay. Question in the back.
So, I want to make one comment about that too. I mean, that's one of the things our company has been very good about doing. Because you need a very low cost and high performing infrared camera to make this succeed for cars, and you need very complex algorithms that can identify pedestrians or animals that are on the road, it's very hard for some companies to get both, and especially the Chinese. They can, and they have been trying to copy the technology. There's many times I've gone to trade shows where I actually go to a Chinese booth and they show the front end of an Audi and they show a camera in the Audi and it happens to be our camera that we built here in Santa Barbara and they make it sound like it's their camera. Well, but they can't get the performance levels of the camera and they can't get the algorithms at the same time. So from that standpoint, that's what we've done to protect ourselves. But there's no question that they are trying.
I'm Philip Jones. I'm the technology reporter at the Pacific Coast Business Times. Arthur, you briefly mentioned that these are in a lot of things, and I was just curious, what are some of the products that thermal cameras are in that the average consumer wouldn't have any clue that they're in?
I think we're at the very early stages of that. I mean, currently we are we have products that are in security cameras that are used to do human detection, so create thermal barriers, thermal fence, we call it. That's the only type of product today. We do sell machine vision products, but that's more of an industrial kind of application. So I would say that, the Lepton, which is our low-cost micro camera, available today in DigiKey and other electronics distributors, we have yet to see adoption of this technology by other verticals. So all the Lepton demand is internal. So everything that we're building is going into our own products. And we're starting to see, and we continue to push very hard to see those OEMs and people that have their own verticals and their own intellectual property and own distribution and own customers and own use cases adopt thermal. But we're early into this effort, so.
Any more questions? No? Okay. Wait 1 second. We'll just hand you you're being filmed.
Is there any breakthrough material coming down to replace vanadium oxide that might have higher sensitivity? Are we stopped at vanadium oxide as the material going forward? All the companies are using it.
Well, I think basically today's flavor is microbolometers, and tomorrow's flavor may be something quite a bit different. There's probably some low-flying cruise missile here that'll come up with a new technology and cause that curve I showed move from the $200 camera to the $20 camera pretty quickly. Right now, in this decade, this point in time, vanadium oxide's working really well. A lot of people are working on technologies that they believe will exceed the performance and reduce the cost of what we're doing. So we see it out there, but it's not developed, and it's a promise. But right now, the amount of money, effort, and manufacturing capabilities behind what we're doing is really hard to get beyond, at least in the near future.
Yeah, and there were many novel technologies that have been tried over the last 20 years. You got to think about where vanadium oxide came from. It was developed in the early 80s, and all along the years, it's been perfected. Let's say 30 years of perfection. These technologies just don't come around so quickly, and we would know about it if some magical technology showed up tomorrow.
Well, Kevin? Let me
just one comment. That while vanadium oxide is the material of choice for most microbolometers, there are some companies that work with amorphous silicon bolometers. L3, for instance, has a foundry that utilizes amorphous silicon.
Annulus,
yeah. Yes.
And I'd also add one thing. You know, you got to understand what's driving this. I mean, are you suggesting that there's benefit to driving performance? And because today, the performance at 100, 150 millikelvin sensitivity seems that there isn't customer demand to get better sensitivity, better performance. So it really is about driving cost, ultimately. And the question, therefore, is, are there other materials and other techniques of fabrication that will drive down cost? I'm sure there will be, but today, you know, by making investments in capital and fine-tuning processes, I don't believe there's a lot of low-hanging fruit in terms of driving cost, replacing vanadium oxide with other materials or bringing on other processes. So I think we're in a state of, as Bill suggested, you know, of maturity, and now we're just going to drive costs in other areas.
Okay, Bob, right in front of you.
What do you think of the future of hybrid solutions, combining visible and infrared, for instance? Looking at features to prevent driving the cost down, let's say.
Why don't you take that, Art?
So we have our standard cell phone product. You know, this does in fact have visible and thermal combined. These products at this resolution level, you know, while they're fine for close range and limited expectations in terms of clearly seeing and understanding what the camera's looking at, by combining that with a visible light image, you can really enhance the image quality and the, you know, and what people perceive they're looking at. So that's a big deal. Beyond, you know, this class of products and this hybrid approach or image fusion, you know, it's a continued area of interest. And, you know, FLIR is certainly developing a wide range of multi-channel imagers to improve the performance of the product, because these visible light cameras are basically free. I mean, they're very inexpensive. The processing, you know, the CPU processing costs continue to go down. It's certainly an area that we'll continue to focus on.
Okay, Bob.
Sorry, just one question I'd like to present to Stuart and Bill. Thanks also for joining this panel. It's very insightful, your comments. I'm curious to hear what you think might shift in the value proposition, particularly to the automotive customers who might not care about image presentation and be interested more just to have the alert of a millimeter wave technology or something that isn't presenting an image. And what have you heard from your customers, for example, Stuart, on the importance of that?
It really depends on the cost of the system. Today, an infrared system in a car costs roughly $2,000. And for that price, our customers have told us, our OEM customers, like for example BMW and Audi and Rolls-Royce and Mercedes, have told us that they want to present an image for that price. At the point where this becomes something you can get on your car for, let's say, $200 or $300, then it may become something that you don't really need the image in order to justify the purchase. So for example, if those videos driving through Santa Barbara had played, you would see that we drive tonight, you know, when we drive at night, you see your headlights illuminate the road, but the fact that you can now pinpoint things on the road or provide an alert, because today our if you buy a BMW, it will alert you that there's, with an audible alert, and also put a icon on your head-up display, if you have a head-up display in the vehicle, will alert you that there's something out there, and that's just not enough. You need to either put a light source on them, or you need to cause the car to take control, or you, of course, have to provide the image.
You know, I watched Autoliv's business model of putting thermal infrared in a car and putting it on the navigation system or some kind of heads-up display, and I just didn't quite hang with it. And then Stuart showed me his video, and I'm really sorry he didn't get to display it, because it is very impressive. of swinging around a headlight and flashing it on a pedestrian on the side of the road was very compelling, because you're just basically driving down the road and all of a sudden you're flashing at a pedestrian. And that autonomous system drove the value of that.
It seems like it's a new computer and it doesn't.
I think they probably loaded your PDF instead of your other program.
No, because the first video went. So.
Oh, the first video went. Okay.
Yeah. Somebody's got a. Yeah, you got one, Rob.
But I think on your website you might have that kind of video content.
In any event, yeah. Some of this autonomous stuff is very compelling.
And I mean, if somebody wants to stay late and after I can go get my computer out of the car and play it for anybody who's interested.
Take us all for drives.
The question is, when you go to a completely autonomous car, you don't need an image. The computer just needs to know that there's something there.
Correct. When you're driving an autonomous car, you need more than one source or one sensor. So you may need a radar on the car, you may need a visible camera, you probably need a night vision camera to be able to truly drive at night. That's what we believe today.
There it is. Oh, it's a Windows, it's a quick, it's a...
So I apologize, we should have tested this. We tested the first video and it worked, so we thought they all worked.
So a question for Bill and Art. So I was really intrigued by the comment about the app crowd and the applications that, you know, you haven't even anticipated. So I wanted to ask, you know, what, if anything, do you guys do to encourage the development of apps that use your low-cost IR plugins for the iPhones?
Well, I think FLIR has taken the first step. You make it available to the maker market, and you release SDKs that people can develop their own applications with, using your camera product, whether it's a core or a camera or something plugs into a computer, and then you go from there to try to build an integrated system for them. So, I think that's a common approach. As well as that, you allow mobile developers to put things on their cell phones and apps that your particular version that you're selling doesn't have, and maybe they sell an app that uses your hardware. So this is all happening, and I think we're finding lots of cool new apps for this stuff.
Yeah, it's a great question. When we launched FLIR 1 at CES in 2014, we had two destinations for people that were interested. You could go to the website, and you could get information about the product. But we also had a website for developers, and you could pre-register. There were pre-registrations to get the product because it wasn't available for shipping, and the SDK wasn't available. We had something like 10,000 people sign up for interest in the product, but we had over 2,500 developers contact us or register to receive the information. And then we had a campaign to reduce that down to 10 as betas, and we went ahead with that. Today, we quarterly have hackathons. So these are they're difficult to execute, but we've seen a number of very interesting applications. One of particular interest was the thermal camera is able to create a green screen effect. So it can see the person, extract the person, and put the person immediately on any background that the app or the customer chooses to do. And it's a very interesting app. So those types of things, the hackathons have turned out to be quite interesting.
There is an ongoing program at UCSB where we have installed a cassette of sensors at hospitals affiliated with the UCs to look at wound healing and the way to predict whether wound healing is going well or not. And thermal sensors are part of this cassette, and they've actually become probably the most best prognosticator for whether, you know, somebody that has broad spectrum burns and that sort of thing are progressing. So it's, you know, something that we just decided to add as one of the sensors, and it's in UCSF and Davis and UC San Diego. So
the Army has done wound care and frostbite care with thermal imaging, and I've been actively involved in medical applications for the 30 years that I've been in this business. I would temper people's enthusiasm about the medical business, though. There's great efficacy with this technology, but it's really difficult to punch it all the way through to, you know, adoption and, you know, insurance reimbursement, and it has continued to be a pick that a lot of people have bent their pick on. A rock that they've bent their pick on. So
don't bend your pick on that healthcare.
That's a tough market. And you noticed in our bubble chart that we had medical, but it was small and below the line. So I will continue to look at it, but that's a tough one.
Yeah, so I encourage the audience, if you think of a application for thermal sensors, please throw them out here. I mean, as Bill said, there's no end to what could be the possibilities in there. It's becoming such an inexpensive technology that it's going to be ubiquitous. I'll pose one question that has, again, to do with kind of the bigger picture, because we like to be comfortable in our spectrum of things. And this has been well-funded by the federal government. I mean, part of the reason why, you know, Lowenstein Lab, Wright-Patterson was getting so much money. How are we doing in terms of being supported for the uncooled technology, or is it all catch as catch can by the, by commercial markets buying you or not buying you?
So my colleagues on the panel tonight, I think, would say that they're doing quite well with respect to the tech base that has been provided over the years, and that the commercial market has now taken over and is driving at least this portion of the IR. There's no question that, to generalize, there's no question that we live in a different times. Corporations, by and large, no longer have central research labs. They have gone away, and government-funded R&D is still an important part of the business, but it is not to the extent that it was in the early days, and it's a different era that we live in.
I would just add that the government tends to fund its industrial base, the people that they rely on to deliver systems for the warfighter. And so, you know, DARPA used to be a big source of funding, but now it has moved to the Army and specifically the Night Vision Laboratories. And they are, in fact, funding the development of smaller pixels, more hybrid or multispectral devices. And so that effort continues. But that tends to benefit, you know, the defense contractors that are focused on defense business. So I won't speak for SEEK, because they're able to leverage the technology developed at Raytheon through their partnership with Raytheon. But for FLIR, we're going alone. So we tend to focus and go at our own cadence with our own investment.
Yeah, our partner does pretty well here, but as a commercial, they would like more.
And we fund everything ourselves as well. We don't get any government funding at all.
Okay, with that, we have any more questions, or are we going to be lucky and see this video, or?
We're trying.
A pause. Technology, it's always interesting. So maybe while we're waiting, another question is, I know some people have traveled far to get to this particular talk tonight. So someone actually, not directly, flew all the way from Cincinnati, but raise your hand if you're farther than LA from here. Okay. Where did you come from? Oh, for this particular talk or for... Okay. Anybody else? because I know the person from Cincinnati, but he was, yep, back there. Okay, well, I think last.
Stuart, you said that you don't get any government funding. You have a very compelling value proposition of saving lives. Why does the Department of Transportation or other agencies not fund auto safety research?
They fund research, and sometimes we do joint research with them. But generally speaking, our company likes to, because when you involve the government, sometimes they own something, and so our company has this feeling that they want to stay totally commercial. And so it's an edict that's come down from our board basically saying we don't want to take money for anything.
Okay, we're going to count to 10. If this doesn't happen, I think we're giving in. Okay. Oh.
Yeah.
That's what happens when you use an old computer. It works.
So you can see there's a pedestrian at a very far distance down the road as well. Clearly you can see the person on the bike. So if you go to the other videos, so here's a scene where you're driving down a road and there's a deer, as I mentioned, way down at the end of the road. And there's also like a little badger or something that's out there too.
It's a dog.
So, and you can see the deer kind of stands there, stuck in the headlights, and
deer
doesn't want
headlights.
To move until the last minute here.
Well, yay. Okay.
Okay, now if you can jump to the last video. Okay, so this one's right here in Santa Barbara, students, and this was not rehearsed or anything. This was, hopefully it's going to work.
Oh. Two computers later, still not working. Oh, well.
I can show it on my computer if somebody wants to come up here and look at it without being projected.
Okay, well, I think I want to thank the panel, and I want to thank Kevin Riley for an exceptional evening, and then thank you as an audience. I hope you get an impression of what MIT Enterprise Forum does every month, except for July, August, and December. So with that, I really want to encourage you to come up and talk to the panel members and get more of an insight, or feel free to have a little more wine. Thank you.